good evening, and thank you for joining us for tonight's Empowered Discussion. Water is something that many of us may take for granted. It's all around us and usually flows freely from our faucets. But recent contamination, droughts, and concerns about climate change are proving the importance of paying attention and protecting our water resources for all who depend on it. Joining us tonight, Ernie Lau, Chief Engineer and Manager for the Honolulu Board of Water Supply. Marty Townsend, Engagement Specialist for Earth Justice. And Dr. Kamana Beamer, a former Water Commissioner and Hawaiian Studies Professor. Thank you all for being with us. Well, we want to start by discussing the contamination at Red Hill. It has been nearly a year now since the water emergency caused by the fuel spill. What can you share about how this is still affecting Oahu's water supply? Ernie.
For the Board of Water Supply, we still have three wells that are shut down as a precaution in that Halawa area, our Halawa shaft, Halawa wells, and Aiea wells. And together, that represents about 13 million gallons a day of supply capacity that would normally feed the Honolulu water system and the Aiea Halawa system. So we're still shut down on those three wells. We continue to ask our customers in those systems and island-wide, because we are in drought conditions right now, to reduce water usage by 10%.
Thank you. And Kamana, what do you see as those lingering impacts? Nearly a year now, can you believe?
Sure. I mean, it's egregious that we've had to suffer this in any case, what was an avoidable crisis because of the Navy's negligence. And it is having lingering impacts for us. As Ernie has said, wells are shut down. Some of the contaminants, trace amounts, are being found in other places. And it's creating, what is a crisis of the future for water on Oahu. Right now, the Navy's requesting more water and to drill new wells at the same time that they haven't cleaned up this mess and they haven't even defueled. So everyone needs to stay very akamai and eleo and vigilant on these impacts.
Thank you. The Navy recently updated its plan for defueling. What are your thoughts on this latest version? Marty.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to participate. And the defueling plan is still incomplete from our review of it. There's still more questions than there are answers. Key things about, Uncle Ernie mentioned, like, the transparency is just not there. It's not to the level that needs to be. The Navy is still not telling us everything that they know, not releasing data on a timely basis. And we're still seeing that, like, things are not being done. They did shave 6 months off the time frame, which is great. Shows it can be done if you try, even a little bit. But what they are, what they're proposing to do, they still don't know what the implications are. Like, they are taking a risk in trying to unpack the fuel from these pipelines, for example. And the fact that the Navy is still the lead agency responsible for defueling the tanks and unpacking the pipes and also providing water to people on the Navy water lines is really a concern for us. There's supposed to be a joint task force established that shares that responsibility across the DOD. And it's not clear why that has not taken shape. There's no leader been identified. That body still needs to be formed. And I think, at this stage, we have to recognize that the Navy cannot handle the situation.
Thank you. And Ernie, your observations on that revised plan.
A positive that, the plan is now 36 pages long. And they did cut it, like Marty said, by 6 months. It shows that you can actually do it shorter. So I would like the Navy to sharpen their pencils and go back and look at how they can even shorten another 6 months or a year. Because as long as fuel is stored there, and there's about 100 million gallons in the pipelines and in the tanks there, right over our drinking water aquifer, as long as it's stored there, it's a continued risk that the aquifer could be further injured by the contamination out of that facility. So they can do better. I do want to commend the Department of Health and the US EPA in asking the Navy to be more transparent and talk about community engagement in this process and keeping people informed. I want to stress that this is a vitally important issue for our community. The future of our water resources in that area is at stake here, And it's important that this issue be done in a transparent way that the community can be kept informed, including the Board of Water Supply, on what they're going to be doing.
Thank you. Now, this spill also raised concerns about the health of that aquifer overall. Is there evidence of contamination there? And what does it all mean to Oahu residents, even those who aren't directly affected by the fuel contamination? Marty?
I mean, we are all directly affected, honestly, because the primary source of water for our island is now offline and may not be brought back online ever. We are in a new normal. People need to come to terms with that. The days of abundant fresh water on Oahu are over. And it doesn't mean that it necessarily has to be all dire and depressing. We can rise to the occasion, but it doesn't take all of us. And so people who feel like they live on the windward side and not affected, they are, because those water sources are probably going to be the ones that are tapped in the future to be able to provide for, you know, urban downtown Honolulu. And really, we need to think about, there's so much in this situation that we need to change. Like Ernie mentioned, we don't have the trust in the Navy. We don't have the transparency we need. Residents are constantly questioning the quality of their water and not sure who they can trust. Releasing data and making it something, a problem that all of us can look at equally and understand is crucial to developing that kind of trust, because we need to be able to rely on the water that's coming out of our taps. And right now, that's in question.
I want to echo, what Marty said is, the future of water on Oahu is forever changed because of these negligent, harmful acts. I think this is the most egregious assault on our public trust resources, our water, the things that provide life for us and all of our community in Hawaii. This is truly terrible. And it is going to continue to have lingering effects because we don't know where that plume will move, and we can't use this amazing water that was in Halawa for centuries because of this.
Ernie, can I ask you to weigh in on that as well? When they say we cannot use this Halawa aquifer, is that forever? Is that until you have absolute proof that it is clean? What kind of timeline are we talking about for hands off that Halawa aquifer?
Gina, right now the timeline is uncertain. There are two important things that need to happen right now. The defueling of the facility and the permanent closure of the Red Hill facility, that's one thing. The other thing is the investigation to define the nature and extent of the damages that have been done to this precious water resources in the underground aquifer in that area. And that investigation needs to proceed at light speed because we don't know how far the contamination may have migrated from the Navy property where the fuel tanks are located, either to the west, toward Ayan Halawa, or toward the east, toward Mauna Loa Valley. And more recently, we've had our first detection of a fuel contaminant in Mauna Loa Valley, something that we never saw before, which is east of the facility. So the timeline for reopening of our three shutdown wells is uncertain. And because of that, we are not waiting. We're also proceeding to look at new water sources to replace that capacity that we currently have lost.
Thank you. Well, with that, we'll have a quick break and we'll be back to discuss the impact of drought on our islands. Welcome back. We want to shift gears now to discuss the impact of drought. Many parts of Hawaii are facing severe drought. Which area of the islands have the biggest problems, and what does it mean for the residents and for farmers? Kamana.
Most of the Kona districts or kind of leeward sides of our islands are experiencing fairly extreme drought throughout our islands, particularly here on Hawaii Island, Kohala, kind of the west end parts of Kona, Waimea, very, very dry in situations that we're really only in the last maybe, 5 to 8 years have we become somewhat familiar to this. Place I live, Waimea, is supposed to be wet and dewy and green grass, and that's changed radically. Some of the climate change models really suggest that, these areas might continue to get increasingly drier over time. And again, this really makes the precious wai that we have running in our streams and feeding our reefs, in our aquifer, that much more, you know, precious and sacred that we have to Malama. For farmers, you know, we really have to adapt our operations. It's not a time where we can waste any drop of water, and we never should have. But this is really the reminder that, you know, for ranchers, for farmers, we have to have drip irrigation. We, you know, gotta try to minimize evapotranspiration of water and do really these best practices. Use mulch to keep your soil moist. And yeah, Malama that way.
Now, what can residents expect to see in the future as this continues, you know, in terms of the food supply and the need for water restrictions? Marty?
Well, I mean, this future is uncertain, more so than it was prior to this latest leak. But I am hopeful that people will rise to the occasion. You know, it wasn't that long ago that Hawaii was the home of master water engineers on every stream. And, you know, we had the ability to move water to where it was needed and support a large population. And I think we can do that again if people change their mindset to treating water as some sort of common enemy and instead treating water as the essential natural resource it is, and seeing ourselves as part of the water cycle, where we are holding water during the wet season and we are, you know, slowly releasing it during the dry season to help not only ourselves sustain through climactic changes, but also, you know, the natural environment around us.
Thank you. Now, will this drought affect development? Are restrictions being proposed to limit development in areas with dwindling water supply on Oahu? Ernie?
Thank you, Gina. At this time, you know, we don't foresee that happening on Oahu. What we want to do is stay ahead of the game, ahead of the demand for future growth by having enough water resources available to meet that demand. But it does take a lot of effort to do that. So even though we've lost 13 million gallons a day of capacity from the Honolulu and the Aiea Halawa system, we don't foresee at this time having to do those restrictions on meters for growth. So we ask that everybody conserve and use water wisely, and developers to look at being more water efficient in their developments. Use as little water as you need for your project. Consider non-potable water uses when you design your projects, so you can preserve the precious high quality drinking water from our underground aquifers for the highest and best use, which is for people using that water to survive.
Thank you. And what about drought-related development restrictions on the neighbor islands? Are those needed? Kamana?
You know, I water is really precious, and it's really on a case-by-case basis when we look at our aquifers. The State Water Resource Management Commission, particularly on Oahu, is going to have to relook at sustainable yield amounts. And the thing is, if we can't pump in certain areas and we're pulling a bunch of water in other areas, we can damage those aquifers in the long term by pulling up, you know, salt water essentially and contaminating them. So we really have to be vigilant.
Well, time now for another quick break, and we'll be right back to discuss some of the long-term solutions. Stay with us. Welcome back to our empowered discussion about the impact of water use on our islands. Using less water is one solution, but how close are we to implementing other solutions used by other locations? Things like desalinization or other off-grid solutions that would gather more water, like catchment. Ernie.
Yeah, thank you, Gina. We are actually in the process of going through the procurement process to construct our first seawater desalination plant on Oahu. It'll be the first one in the state for any county water department. So hopefully that project will make it through. It's 1.7 million gallons a day capacity, expandable to 5 million gallons a day. So that desalination is one point. The other thing is, I think we have to look at treating water of all qualities or all types, including stormwater and wastewater, as resources that we manage as a whole. So taking the one water approach to water management in Hawaii. Reuse of recycled wastewater is going to be very important for us, especially on the Ewa Plain. And I think there's greater opportunity for more use there that'll save our high quality precious drinking water quality water from the underground aquifers for a higher and better use.
Thank you. And Marty, can you weigh in on that too? Ernie spoke to some of the municipal level things, but what can we do at our own homes? You know, catchment is something folks on the Big Island are familiar with, but should more of us on Oahu be saving and using the water that falls right at our homes?
Yeah, I think there's a lot that individual homeowners can do to catch water and save it. And the Board of Water Supply has a program to help homeowners retrofit their gutters to be able to hold water. And that's a good thing. And also, like, I am very suspicious and speculative about desalinization plant. I think there's a lot of unintended consequences and potential harms that come from that amount of energy that's used, amount of brine we'll have to figure out something to do with. And I would rather that we focus on the things that we can do right now. Like for right now, the Navy is pumping and dumping 5 million gallons of water a day into the lava stream. That water can be reused. Our storm waters, we flush them out into the ocean, damaging our nearshore waters. We can catch that water and clean it and reuse it. There are a lot of things that we can do within our system right now. There's just so much leakage, so much waste in the way that our system is currently designed, that if we really put our focus on it, sharpen our pencils, as Uncle Ernie likes to say, really figure out ways to live our lives that use the least amount of fresh drinking water, then we can have a bright future on Oahu.
I know we touched on this a bit. And Ernie, did you want to weigh in on that?
Gina's absolutely right. We actually have a rebate for people to do rain barrel catchment systems. So at a residential level, you could just catch the rain that falls on your roof that flows out of your down your gutter and use it for irrigation around your home. Marty, I understand the concerns about desalination. You know, we're trying to be very careful and environmentally sustainable in how we approach it. So desalination does take a lot of power. So the idea of teaming renewable energy systems with a desal plant really makes sense. So we don't have to depend on fossil fuel energy-based energy.
Yeah, there's a lot to unpack there, and I think there's a lot we can do between then and like what we're doing right now and the point at which we need a desal plant where we could actually save a lot of water.
And you're absolutely right. Managing water demand through water conservation, everybody can take personal responsibility to do their part to do that.
And we also just need to get comfortable with brown parks, because we're not going to be able to water landscaping as much as we used to. And also, I think, we need to take into consideration those people who don't live in single family homes. If you're living in an apartment, doing catchment is not really an option for you. But there may be things that you can do as a building together as a community that helps to reduce, groundwater use.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you for the vibrant discussion. Now, we're almost out of time, but stay with us for some final thoughts. Well, welcome back. We're almost out of time, so let's close with a final message to Hawaii residents as we face these water challenges. With water all around us and so readily available, why should we all still be concerned for the future if these current water challenges continue? Kamana?
Yeah, we all understand how precious water is. We all care about life in our islands, regardless of our ethnicity and cultural perspectives, political perspectives. We understand water is precious. And the thing is, we all can act. We can clean up Red Hill, get the Navy to be accountable for that. We can ask our politicians to create better policies to conserve water. We can rebuild urban environments with pervious structures that many cities around the world are thinking about capturing water. And so there's a lot of solutions for us. And in our homes, we can teach our keiki about the preciousness of Hawaii. And we can talk about a time when all the water was pure on Oahu, but that's not the case now. And so we need to be vigilant and we need to fix this and get the fuel out of Red Hill and decommission those tanks forever.
Thank you. Marty.
Just to build on that, yes, remain vigilant. The main thing that I think people can do right now going forward is support policies and systems that reduce contamination risks for our water. There's firefighting foam and forever chemicals that are already showing up in our water supply. We need to regulate those. They aren't unregulated. We need to be vigilant on large water users and making sure that they are as sustainable as possible and using the least amount of water. We need to think about ourselves as part of the water cycle, and that we are all have a role to play in, you know, protecting our island's ecosystem and making sure we can make it through the drought that is, you know, coming, as well as the contamination risk that we are currently exposed to. And the more we can do to hold the Navy accountable and reduce the risk of additional contamination, the better for our future.
Thank you. And Ernie.
Kamana and Marty have said it so well. I can have barely anything to add here, but if I can add maybe two things. I think one of our ability to survive and thrive in this challenging time of climate change is going to be really critical for us to be able to work together as a community at all different sectors, the private sector, the government sector, to the individual, to the large companies, to the military. We need to all work together in a community to realize that our natural resources are finite and they're vulnerable. They're vulnerable to damage. So source water protection, like Marty said, it is going to be critically important to our future. Our precious Vi in these underground aquifers, the Vi flowing in streams, they're finite resources. They're high quality, but it's easily damaged by our activities over the aquifer along the streams. So we need to work together to protect this water, our source water, our Vi, for our future. And our decisions on how we decide to do our activities over these that could impact these resources, we should look at them on the long term, 100 years or more on a decision. When you think back at Red Hill, 79, almost 80 years, built nearly a century ago, and we're feeling the impacts of that, those decisions made in 1940 today. So long term, long view, work together, protect the precious Vi, groundwater and surface water.
All right. And with that, we thank you, our panelists, for joining us tonight. And we thank you at home for watching. We hope you've all learned some important ways that you can act now to preserve our water resources. Aloha and good night.